very politicized with many vested interests, and one of the big calls I think one should make to enlightened business leaders today is on the corporate statesmanship side. Historically, business has always joined lowest common denominator chambers and the likes, who of course then use their lobbying influence to have a lock on public policy making. But more recently, some of these old boy clubs are giving way to new voices who no longer think it makes actually business sense to lobby against climate policies. So that trend is slow, but it is happening before our eyes, and the best thing I think we can do is to accelerate this change and to make it as fast as possible. But still, Governor Brown still is an inspiration to many around the world on climate change, and the trading system of California still is very important on the carbon side and inspires many other jurisdictions around the world. So it's a very mixed bag, I would agree. And you mentioned two corporate names. Well, one is getting a Missy Robertson, I believe. So, you know, leadership matters too. So maybe the time has come now to make voices heard.
I'm Simon Schretter. I'm a fellow, actually, at the College of Professor of History and Public Policy at the History Faculty. Of course, what you've been describing to us is, George, is effectively a kind of a political battle that you're at the beginning of or a little way into. And the normal kind of resources, key resources in a political battle or information. And I'm just wondering, as I listen to the different, particularly the skeptical comments and so on, whether, is there enough information available as yet, do you think, where to draw up an actual, a league table of corporations? I mean, gentleman here pointed out there's a film talking about corporations as being like persons. Well, one thing that people don't like is that their name is, sneered in public for valid reason, but not smeared for bad reason, but it's hard for them to deny that they're not living up to things, etc. So do you think that, I mean, we have league tables through the UN, the World Bank, the CIA, etc., which gives all kinds of information about countries and about what they're doing, infant mortality rates, literacy rates, corruption rates, and so on. And those league tables have actually, over time, been really quite influential and important. They work in the end. Do you think we have sufficient information? Are there organizations that are able to produce sufficient information that we can actually properly evaluate corporations on several crucial dimensions, so sustainability, equality, promotion, these sorts of issues, secrecy. Do we have enough information to do this for at least, let's say, the 500 most important corporations in the world? I mean, or are we really a very long way from that? Because it seems to me that one of the crucial weapons, resources in a political battle would be to generate that information and create a public discourse around information about that league table and which corporation is moving up, moving down month by month. It would create the sort of public discourse that they would find hard to avoid.
Well, this question goes to the core of one of the arguments I tried to establish in my talk, and it's the short answer. I think the information is getting better by the month, by the year certainly. This new organization, Europe-based GSR, is trying to accomplish exactly that. Because currently the information is highly fragmented, and it needs a lot of expert digging to go to the bottom of it. Most people don't have the energy or the bandwidth to really do a deep dive into the background. There is increasingly sophisticated information available, but putting it together into a solid benchmark or index is not easy. The fragmentation of that information is actually a barrier for many analysts even to use ESG performance, for example. But it's getting better every year, and it's a big world out there with many languages and many jurisdictions, but I have no doubt that this is the direction where it's moving. But there's always welcome demand for more to be done. And by the way, here in the UK, there are some great, great organizations which have critically given birth to this movement, EITI, CEDEX, and the likes on the supply chain. The Carbon Disclosure Project is a huge success story, and a number of others. So the UK has a very, very strong tradition on the disclosure and transparency side, and many of the initiatives which were first initiated in the UK are now global. So, no clear answer, but the infrastructure for ESG information is out there. It's highly fragmented. Many of the deep assessments are still proprietary. They are done by individuals, organizations, and use those as a competitive advantage. My optimism in this comes from the simple fact that ESG performance increasingly is associated with long-term success, including financial success. It's not a contradiction, there's a positive correlation. When you talk about individual companies, it is very difficult to establish a clear causality between environmental stewardship, how well they treat their workers, the supply chain performance and financial success. It is not easy because financial success can be the outcome of many circumstantial factors, competition, technology, demand, and so forth. It's very difficult to establish a causality between ESG performance and financial success one-to-one. But if you aggregate companies upwards in a quantitative approach, if you have many companies, then on average it's ever more true that good ESG performance is linked with superior or good financial performance. And this is a very, very powerful argument because it basically establishes the fact that good sustainability performance not only is good, but it also pays. And if that argument is understood by the financial world, then clearly future investment goes into sustainable companies, more sustainable companies, and by doing so will greatly accelerate the transformation. And we are, I believe, at the crust of exactly that, because the evidence is fairly recent. Up to not too long ago, there were illustrative examples. You could easily show when companies got it wrong, but it was very costly. So it was easy to bring the evidence and the costs of getting it wrong. It was far more difficult to bring in evidence of getting it wrong. And as this evidence is becoming more robust now, I believe the race is on for good ESG performance. It's becoming a competitive tool. It's a comparative advantage. And also locations, by the way, countries increasingly discover that actually we cannot attract good new investment if we have a rotten infrastructure, if there's crime, and if there's pollution and toxic waste everywhere. This is not an environment for attracting creative new investment. And I'm also mentioning one country, I was involved not too long ago in Tanzania, advising them on a new regulatory framework for the mining sector. And there were two positions in the government. One said, okay, the less regulation and environmental prescriptions we have, the more investment we could attract. And there was the other camp who argued just the opposite. Actually, if we put forward high standards for potential investors, we would actually attract the good investment. And luckily, the second camp won, and exactly that happened. So we are not in a race to the top. We are already in a resource-constrained global economy where there's increasingly put a premium on mastering environmental efficiency. There's increasing evidence from management theory and practices that empowering and non-discrimination of people is the way to unlock productivity and creativity. The old models of looking at labor just as a commodity, where labor We're moving into a knowledge-intensive, creative phase where increasingly the premium is of inclusion and power. So I do believe that in this more enlightened market context, actually, there's positive affinity between sustainability performance and long-term financial success. And the data is coming in rapidly because the demand for ESG information is skyrocketing. The curves are going up, whether it is Bloomberg, whether it is MSCI, Sustainalytics, or many of the other major players, all of them are moving into that space now. Because even the service providers now recognize that one of the future of connecting investors to the real economy is providing that information. And already on the Bloomberg terminals, you can see ESG screens, which now integrate to the other short-term information. Imagine that on Bloomberg terminals, you get ESG information already offered. I think it's wonderful. We need much more. Actually, ESG should be on the top, and the short-term stock information should be somewhere in the back, you know, for some old-timers who still races on something else. It's gambling. No, it's no longer gambling. We live now in a world where transparency about ESG performance increasingly is taken as a precondition for long-term success. And this is the promise of this fusion between the world of finance on the one hand and the real economy on the other.
In the interest of time, we're just going to take one more quick question, and then we're going to have to take a look on that.
So first, I was thinking it would be kind of cool for us all to go to the pub afterwards and discuss further. And the Eagle is kind of big enough to accommodate many of us. And maybe you could all of the positive investment cadres people put their hands up so that people don't have to talk to us more about what we're up to. Yeah, it's a big group. Positive Investment Cambridge is working on how to get the, admirably outlined for us, is working on how to get the universities, colleges, and central endowment to basically become an exemplar for other institutions. So come join us at the pub afterwards and talk about that or other stuff. That would be great. Also, Georg, I'm just wondering if you could give us some strategy advice. Given what you know about the corporate realm and the financial realm, what can students most effectively do to influence them?
Well, I understand you have already accomplished quite amazing things. So at times it's actually good to step back and to take stock of what you have accomplished already. When I listened to Edward in the beginning, you know, and I know from you, Ellen, some of the path-breaking work you have already been doing, wow, keep that going. Secondly, I think persistence is the most important thing here. We're talking about deep, big change, and established organizations always are reluctant to change their policies. It's the nature of the beast. Every organization has an inbuilt resistance to their change. Because with it comes many things, from jobs to procedures to the known versus the unknown. So you have to accept the fact that big organizations are not open for change. The way to break in is to be persistent, persistent, persistent. I have no doubt. And I will also target some of the enlightened people who are decision makers and involve them. That will accelerate your long march through the organization. It will expedite your efforts. If you allow me, I'll give you one personal example from my life. It was a lousy life in that regard. But I was obsessed in the 60s when I was at the in changing the culture in Germany, because the older generation was not prepared to face the past. And it became an obsession. It became a big battle. It was certainly more important. But it took a whole generation. It wasn't an easy goal in a sweep you can do with a rational argument in one goal. You have to be persistent. So persistence is number one. Focus on enlightened people who are in positions of influence. Win them over, invite them, make a rational argument. And rational thinking is what will carry the day on these issues. because your proposition is based on rational thinking. On that one, my favorite quote, by the way, is an Italian writer whose name just doesn't come to my mind yet, but who basically argues that it's time to develop a new ethic for rational thinking, because the myths of the past still give meaning to people's lives and hold back the much needed changes the world needs today. Make rationality your argument, build a case on clear-cut propositions, and you will win the day. But you have to be persistent. Within the UN, for example, it has taken me almost 20 years to establish a relationship with the private sector. In the beginning, this was impossible, because there was an ideological divide. There were those who belonged to the Soviet Empire in the old days, in central planning and anti-market, and then there were the free marketeers on the other side. It led to the fact that the UN had to be neutral, and its whole DNA became anti-markets, or not knowing even how to relate to the market. It took 20 years to open up the organization, to build at least a mechanism by which we can influence markets and work with markets. This kind of change doesn't come easy, and what you're working on are some of the biggest issues humanity is facing today. So don't expect a quick fix. This requires persistency based on rational thinking, based on the great tradition of this great place, Cambridge, which is your alma mater here. I think you have more than a fair chance. And after all, you are the future. You can choose with your own decisions, with your own investments, with your own behavior. And as you get older, so in your ability also to shape the next generation in your own behavior. So that's all I can share. Sorry, I don't have a silver bullet for you, but I know you're doing all great work. Thank you very much.